Yes. So thank you very much once again for the invitation. Yeah, so I'm going to talk about a little bit, the topic is slightly different, well, a lot different than what Paolo was talking about. So Paolo was talking about termination of flips, and what I'm interested currently in is abundance and sort of post-abundance problems, which I will explain. So everything I say today, I mean now, is over C. And partly it's joined with Tobias Dorsch. And the other part is a work in progress with Thomas Petenel and KG Ogizo. So so the question is what's happening somehow towards the end of the MMP in the sense of abundance, and if we know abundance, some consequences of it. So the main, in my view, the main remaining open problem in the MMP in characteristic zero is the existence of good models. So. A good model is a minimal model on which abundance holds. Das heißt, oh, sorry, this was German. Sorry, I want to say that means that each variety X should have a good model, which is a model, again, x min, such that kx min is semi-ample. And that's important because somehow the logic of the MMP should be that all varieties are rationally built out of three types of varieties. One with k positive, which is ample, one with k trivial, and one with k negatives, so Fano. And the logic is, so here as always, kx is pseudo-effective. And when kx is not pseudo-effective, then Paolo was already talking about this. These are the Mori fiber spaces, and that's the situation where we are reaching the model z, which has a fibration over something else. So let's call it w. And general fiber is a Fano variety. So somehow you are reducing your study into the base and the fiber, and the fiber is Fano, and then the base can further be decomposed. In this situation, if we really have kx semi-ample, then we have a fibration over something else, and the general, so the, here the fiber is Fano, so the fiber is Fano, and here the fiber is Calabiao. And what I mean, Calabiao, in a sense that so if f is a general fiber, then kf is numerically trivial. And there are two cases, either the base, so two cases, either the base it has small dimension than the base, so, than the dimension of x, and then you are somehow really splitting your study of x into the fiber and the base, and the base is the low dimension, the fiber is Calabiao. Or the second one, when the dimension of s is equal to the dimension of x, then at least when x has a terminal singularity, then you can show that ks is ample. And that's where the positivity of k comes in. So somehow in the logic should be, if you know everything in MMP, abundance included, then your every variety should be rationally split into these three different types of, so k negative, k positive, and k trivial. So traditionally, this is the existence of good models. And So here I'm only implying existence of one, somehow wanting existence of one good model, which is good enough for me. And traditionally, in a sense, this splits, so the problem of existence of good models, this splits into two problems. One is existence of the minimal models, where kx is an f, and then proving the abundance conjecture, which then says that on a minimum model, kx is actually semi-ample, so abundance conjecture. And this guy here, traditionally, in a sense, how we how the abundance conjecture is proved in dimension three, this splits into two parts. One is non-vanishing, where you are first required to show that. So if you're this is happening on, let's say, x. So then you first you are required to show that kx has sections, so some h naught of mkx is non-zero. And then once you have one section, then proving semi-ampleness. And it's somehow, I think the more I think about this problem, it's not so clear which one is more difficult, 2A or 2B. Somehow I think the conventional wisdom would say that 2A is the most difficult. The more I think about it, the less I'm convinced about this thing. Okay, so what is known? Okay, what is known? So abundance is known, so for when you only consider x without any boundary and x is a terminal variety, or in the notation of Paolo, A of E x delta is bigger than 1, then, sorry, delta is 0. Then this was proved by for threefolds. So this is a dimension of x is 3. This was proved in the 80s and 90s by Miyoka and Kawamata. And then in general, when x delta has low canonical singularities, it was generalized, this proof was generalized by Kiel, Matsuki and McKernan. And somehow there is also a version of this thing when the variety X is assumed not to be irreducible, but I'll come to this in a second. Okay, so so also what is maybe that was somehow left, I think, incomplete after our talks from the morning. What is known? Okay. So let me just write what is known in the MMP, in the MMP in different flavors of the MMP. So first one is characteristic zero, projective. Here, so MMP is known in dimension three, small equal than three, and this is many people. Kawamata, Shokurov, Mori, of course, and then all these guys, Miyoka, Kiyomatsuki, McKernan. So flips exist in all dimensions. Good models exist in all dimensions when you have this paired x delta, KLT, and delta is big. So in particular, that also includes the case when kx plus delta is big. Yeah, and I think that's more or less. There are some additional cases. For example, termination of flips, termination of canonical flips. in dimensions at most 4. Okay, now there is a there is a recent progress in characteristic P. Paolo knows more about this, so I'll probably make a mistake, but what is known? So nothing is known in dimension at least 4. In dimension 3, so minimum models exist. In dimension 3, I suppose also modifiable spaces exist in dimension 3. Abundance is nothing is known. And a canonical ring is fine to generate in dimension 3. Once again? Ah, yes, that's right. So, and the characteristic is at least 7. That's right. So, canonical ring is fine to generate. For threefolds. So these are several people. I mean, Paolo, Xu, Haken, Birker, Waldron. Yeah. And recently, Keller. So characteristic 0, of course. And Keller geometry, which was single-handedly done by 2 people. So this is Petanil and Hering. So everything is known in dimension 3. So existence of minimum models, abundance, modifiable spaces. So these are the different flavors of MMP, okay? So now, what else is known, what you say about abundance? KLT abundance. So if you know abundance for KLT pairs implies log canonical abundance. I'm probably going to make a mistake, but this is Gongyo Fujino and Heikong Shu. I will explain what this means. Log canonical abundance is equivalent to semi-log canonical abundance. So how one should understand this thing is that this is a irreducible version. So you are reducible varieties. And as explained by Paolo, and this is a reducible version. So you are allowing more than one component of X. So, and I think when I say next, it'll be clear where this SLC abundance is, in which context it's important. And when I say existence of good models, and one can argue, okay, but what about flips and termination and stuff? So what is important to note is that existence of good models is equivalent to say that there exists a sequence of operations in the MMP which terminates. So, and this was, I suppose, first written down by Lai, I think. So, so why is this important? Okay, so there are many things in the if you want to test a conjecture, for example, on a projective variety, and then how you want to prove the conjecture, you want to somehow translate the conjecture. You do the MMP, translate the conjecture to the minimum model, and then prove it on the minimum model, and then somehow pull it back via these operations in the minimum model program. And that's why these sequence of operations in MMP is important. Not only existence of good models, but also that this map to the good model factorizes into reasonable maps, which are flips and divisorial contraction and so on. Okay, so there are several, I would say, two main approaches to abundance. So several approaches to abundance. So this is, I mean, partly a survey talk as well, because so one is extension theorems. And what I mean by this, so that means find a suitable subvariety S in your variety X. So abundance, when I say abundance, somehow I to me this is more or less simultaneous to existence of good models. So I'm not really differentiating between these two. And what's important here, this guy is not necessarily irreducible. And this is where this SLC abundance will come into play. And so find a suitable subvariety S and non-zero subspace V in the H naught of S M times KS plus delta on S. Ah, sorry, KX plus KX plus delta on S. And the surjection of the global sections M KX plus, oh. Well, this has never happened to me, so this is something. Okay, and the surjection of this vector space onto V. Okay, so of course this vector space depends on M. Okay. So this would imply non-vanishing. Okay, in particular, this if somehow if you want to show that K plus delta has some has sections. And if this surjects onto a non-empty, non-zero set, then this guy definitely has sections. This would imply that part. However, even even further, if we assume that we have sections, so if so now if we assume if we already have sections. Then, so, KX plus delta, that means that KX plus delta is Q-linear equivalent to some effective divisor D, and we can assume the following. We can assume that the support by some, there is some technical work which is not terribly deep in this thing, that the support of delta is equal to the support of D. And the round down of delta is not empty. So that means that we have some components in this of with coefficient 1 in this guy. And let's denote this by S, conveniently, by S. Additionally, also, I cannot really go into details, but also by a paper of Lai, we can assume that kappa of kx plus delta is equal to zero. Because if it's somehow if it's bigger than zero, then we can use induction on dimensions. Okay, and then the extension theorem of that form, then. So the extension theorem is somehow, yeah, the extension theorem would imply that S, so if you can somehow find such a suggestion like there, that S is not in the stable base locus of Kx plus delta, where this is just the intersection of all the, so this is just the intersection over all m in n on the base loci of m times kx plus delta. And that would in particular imply, so the S is not in the stable base locus. However, this condition implies that k plus delta is a fixed divisor, and that's a contradiction. So, and S is already in the support of D. So this is already a, this is a contradiction. So my point is that such an extension theorem, if it can be found, would more or less immediately prove abundance. We are not very far in this direction. So what is known, so there is an extension theorem proved by Demaihe, Hekkonen, and Pound, but there is a strong, there are strong restrictions on what S can be. I mean, somehow S can be, S has to be reducible. The singularities of k plus delta, of x comma delta have to be of a certain form. So it's a good extension theorem in the sense that it doesn't assume any bigness or ampleness assumption, but the assumptions on the singularities are very hard to achieve in practice. Okay, and I suppose the second approach, which I suppose is only approach in theory so far, but not in practice, is restriction to characteristic P. So, I mean, there are, here I think, I suppose nothing is known. So if, so we assume that kx is an f. So if we knew, and so xp will be my restriction, any restriction of x modulo p. So restriction. Of x modulo p. And if we knew, so this is not known. So it's a conjecture, but I suppose it's not known. That kx p is nef for say p very large, p prime very large. And if somehow we could prove abundance in characteristic p, but in a sort of uniform way, and if we could show that mkxp is non-zero, non-empty, for m independent of p, then we could know that mkx has sections by semi-continuity. So, I mean, this is highly, I mean, speculative. I mean, because we, I mean, this is not known, and even if this was known, I mean, this. Is, so, but somehow that would maybe motivate one approach to abundance conjecture. No, I have no idea. I mean, that's I'm speculating raised to 10. I mean, I have no idea. So. I mean, you tell me. You are expert in the characteristic P. I have no idea. So okay. So let me. So far as you can see here, I mean, many reduction steps are known. So somehow I mean, type of singularities which are allowed and so on. And with Gongyo, with Doash, we proved. The following. So now just a piece of notation. If x delta is a KLT pair, this pair is called, it is uniruled or respectively non-uniruled. So this is just a notation, nothing else. If x itself is non-uniruled or uniruled. So recall that uniruled means that through every point there is a singular rational curve on X, or equivalently there is a dominant map of P1. There is a dominant map, a dominant onto X, where dimension of Y is dimension of X minus 1. So that means that X is uni-ruled. And this is clearly aberrational property. And theorem A is then that abundance for non-uni-ruled. So this is again in a sort of vein like these somehow reduction theorems. This is a reduction theorem. Abundance for your non-uni-ruled KLT pairs in dimension n implies abundance for uni-ruled KLT pairs in dimension n, assuming whatever you want in dimension n minus 1. So assuming MMP, assuming MMP in dimension smaller than equal n minus 1. And you can also replace this word abundance here by the existence of good models. Implies also existence, so existence of good models. Somehow, that's why I somehow think that these two problems are not separable from each other. So, once again? Let me put it like this, for MMP for KLT pairs, for KLT pairs. I was going to say that it implies the general MMP, but I'm not sure. Abundance implies log-canonical abundance, but I don't know if it's termination of flips. Does KLT termination of flips imply? No, so okay, maybe. So let's MMP for, once again? Of what? No. I will say what I mean. So I just mean it's covered by rational curves. And so this, there is some reduction step. So there's something called the terminal models. So by passing to a terminal model of X delta, we can assume that the pair X delta is not KLT, but it's terminal. So this is known from BCHM. And then there is a result by Buxom, de Maille, Pound, and Petanel, which says that in this case, X, so in this case, when it's a terminal, X delta is uni-ruled if and only if Kx is not pseudo-effective. So in a sense, so the point is that by passing to terminal model, you can assume this KLT here is just it's not really important. You can assume that it's KLT, that it's a terminal pair. And then what this says is that if you start with X delta terminal pair, so then abundance for pairs with Kx pseudo-effective implies abundance for pairs where Kx is not pseudo-effective. So that's the, by this reduction step. Does this answer your question? Yeah. Okay. So, yes. So let me say very briefly something about the proof, and then I will go to the concordant. So first, something about the numerical dimension. So this was first introduced by Kawamata in the context of NEF divisors, and then extended by Nakayama in the context of pseudo-effective divisors. So X is a projective variety. D is a pseudo-effective R divisor, So everything for me is R Cartier. So everything. If you are not happy with R, then assume Q. It doesn't matter. And then consider two values. One is sigma of dA, for where A is so A is any Cartier divisor. And this is a supremum K in N, such that liminf. I mean, when you see it for the first time, then it looks horrible because no one knows what this means. But I will explain what this means in an example. H naught of MD plus A, round down. So if you're not happy with this, just assume that D is Cartier. So there is no round down here. Over MK is bigger than zero. So this is a sort of enhanced version of Kodaira dimension. Because if you set A equals zero, then this is a Kodaira dimension. But this is not a numerical dimension. The numerical dimension is defined as the supremum of all these values where A runs through ample guys. So somehow, the point is Kodaira measures H naught of MD over MK, and this measures a small perturbation by an ample divisor. And what is obviously known is obviously clear that that kappa sigma is at least kappa. So facts, there are, let me write some facts that I will need. So if D is nef, so what does it mean? If D is nef, this is equivalent, so this is equivalent to this kappa sigma is of xd is the supremum of all k in n, such that the cycle, really this scheme theoretic cycle d to the k is not numerically zero. So in particular, kappa sigma is zero if and only if d is numerically trivial. Okay, then if f y to x is a surjective proper morphism, then the following is true. So kappa and kappa sigma behave well with respect to pullbacks. So kappa of xd is kappa of y f upper star d, and kappa sigma of behave the same. If x, the pair x delta is KLT, then the pair has a good model, and this is why this this kappa sigma is important. X delta has a good model if and only if kappa of kx plus delta is equal to kappa sigma of kx plus delta. It's a funny exercise to try to show this, if you've never seen it before, that this guy implies kappa equal kappa sigma. Kappa equal, the converse implication is much more difficult. And so this was proved by Gongyo and Lehmann. And finally, okay, I will not, the next fact I will not say. And the main technical result, which I will just sketch the proof, is the following. Existence of good models for log smooth KLT pairs x delta with the property that the linear system kx, really not the multiple, but the linear system is not empty. So this is in dimension n. So this is in dimension n. Implies existence of good models for uniruled KLT pairs in dimension n, again assuming MMP in dimension small a equal to n minus 1. So this main technical result clearly implies theorem A by this BDPP result. Okay, so I would just, in the next 5 minutes, do the reduction steps. So reduction step . So first definition, so if X delta is a KLT pair, G, an effective Q divisor, such that with the property that KX plus delta plus G is pseudo-effective, then the pseudo-effective threshold tau of X delta with respect to G is the minimum of all T in R such that K plus delta plus TG is pseudo-effective. And then the theorem hard, let's say, is the following. As you assume existence of good models in dimension n minus 1, at most, let's say, at most n minus 1, let X delta be a KLT pair, G, again, effective Q divisor, such that the pair X comma delta plus G is, again, still KLT, so you're not making a singularity worse, such that KX plus delta plus G is pseudo-effective, but KX plus delta is not pseudo-effective. So that in particular means that tau, which is the tau of X0 comma G is bigger than zero. That can be seen from the definition. Then there exists a good model for the pair X delta plus tau G. Oh, sorry, this is not zero, sorry, this is delta. Yeah, and in particular, because the good model exists, then the kappa of kx plus delta plus tau g is not minus infinity. And now, this is essentially proved in Demailly, Haken, and Pound. We just noticed that their proof for something else proves actually this stronger result. And now, start with a uniruled pair X delta, and somehow you want to reduce to the case where this guy is not uniruled, and passing to a suitable model we can assume by the result of the BDPP as above that KX is not pseudo-effective, because if it were pseudo-effective, then I mean it's the same reduction step as before. Okay. And then, in particular, by applying this theorem star to the situation when delta is zero and G is delta, then we have that the Kodaira dimension of tau delta, of k plus tau delta is at least zero. So in particular, this guy is at least zero. So this is by theorem star. Sorry, not theorem star, theorem Hart. OK. And now one, so now we know that one is greater or equal than tau. So tau was this, this is, sorry. This is absolute effective threshold of now of this this pair x0 with respect to delta. And this is bigger than 0 because kx is not absolute effective. And then there are two cases. So two cases. Either, so case A, say, tau is equal to 1. And then we are done because by theorem star, theorem Hart. Because the theorem Hart exactly says that in that case, k plus delta has a good model. Or case B is, of course, tau is small than 1. And then so somehow this looks very, very funny condition. What can one do with it? But then a very simple trick does something. So there exists d tau. So again, by theorem star, theorem's Hart, there exists, in particular by this last part, there exists d tau in effective divisor such that kx plus t delta is q-linear equivalent to d tau. And then by adding 1 minus tau delta up to both sides, then you get that kx plus delta is q-linear equivalent to d tau plus 1 minus t delta. And let's call this guy d. And what is the point of this thing? The point is that the support of delta is then in the support of, the support of delta is contained in the support of d. So that's the first reduction step. And then by some addition, some more work, which I will skip. We can assume the following. We can assume x delta is log smooth. The support of delta is equal to the support of d. Yeah. And now, replace delta by round up of delta. So increase all the coefficients to 1, more or less if you assume, if you change a little bit the assumptions of the main technical result, you don't lose anything. So we can assume that delta divisor is reduced. So these are all very, very, very small technical steps. And then now that we come to the crucial point. Kx plus delta, which because x is smooth, delta is reduced, so this is a line bundle, which is q-linearly equivalent to d. And let m be the smallest positive integer, which makes this linear equivalence into q-linear equivalence into linear equivalence. So let m be the smallest positive integer, such that m times l is linearly equivalent to m times d, and let's call this guy g. And there are two cases, so two cases again. Let's call it I, m equal 1. And this is not possible, because if m equals 1, then kx is linearly equivalent to g minus delta, and the support of g and the support of delta is the same, and this has all coefficients 1, and this has all coefficients at least 1. So this is an effective divisor, which would then, by BDPP, again, imply that x is not uniruled. So this is a contradiction. And this somehow tells us what we are looking for. So we are, of course, then constructing the cyclic covers. So then, so M is at more, at least one, and at least two, I mean. And then let pi y to x be the M-fold cyclic cover along this this section G. Okay, and then when we know this, what do we get above on Y? What do we get on Y? Then we get that pi upper star G is M times some line bundle G prime, such that pi upper star of kx plus delta is G prime. And the G prime reduced, so I'm taking all the coefficients of G prime to be one. This is some divisor delta prime, and then Hurwitz formula says that the pullback of kx plus delta is equal to kx prime plus delta prime. Okay, so now if x prime delta prime is log smooth, which is never happening, but let's pretend, then we are again done. Again, by the same trick as in one. So we reach something which is not uniruled. I mean, it's not a contradiction, but we just reach something which is not uniruled, and then the main technical result is true. And then, which this is never true, but I mean, then we take if not, then take a log resolution. And then some calculation, so you have to be careful. so careful analysis of discrepancies shows that that the resolution is not uniruled. Okay. So we again. What I wanted to say, forgot to say, we are done again by as in part one. But here, what we're using, the so here we are using the facts about kappa and kappa sigma. So kappa and kappa sigma are preserved by these operations by pulling back by a finite map. Okay, so this is just a sketch of the proof. I mean, many details are missing, but just somehow to show how such a thing can be done. Okay, now I want to talk about something which in conferences, workshops, is not very often talked about, which is the Kohn conjecture, and why it's important. And it took me a long time to understand why it's important, but I'm pretty convinced. So the Kohn conjecture. And this is a post-abundance problem, as I will try to explain in a second. So there are two versions of the Kohn conjecture. So we are always dealing with X Calabiau, and Calabiau in the most in the widest possible sense, we are just assuming that Kx is numerically trivial. And if you are not happy, I mean, so here we can assume that X has KLT singularities. But in practice, we are almost always assuming that almost always that X at least terminal, if not smooth. And then there are two versions. So I will write them together. So then there exists a rational polyhedral fundamental domain uh, for the action, I will explain what this means, for the action of the automorphism group of X on. And then now there are two versions. One is the cone nef of X intersection effective cone of X. So really you are taking the nef classes which are effective. And the second version is, so this is Kawamata's version. And I think only now we're understanding the relationship with these two versions. And the second one is you take the nef cone of X, then you take the all the rational points inside, and then you take the convex hull. So you take, so this might not be, I mean, this is not a convex cone, but you take a convex hull, okay? And it's easy to see that automorphism group preserves both of these cones, so this is really well-defined. So what does it mean? So this is the statement of the cone conjecture. So what does it mean that there is a rational polyhedral fundamental domain? That means, so this means there exists a rational polyhedral cone, pi, such that the action of automorphism group really tessellates these cones into translates of pi. So such that, let's say, nef x intersection f, x is the union of all the translates of pi by elements of the automorphism group, and they are disjoint, the interiors of these guys are disjoint, interior of pi intersection interior of g upper star pi is empty unless this action g star is identity. So you're really having somehow, in a sense, disjoint union of actions of the elements g alpha star pi. Okay, why is this important? So okay, and this guy here is a Morrison. Morrison's version. So why is this important? So Kawamata's version. So I suppose many people, I mean, including me, for a very long time, assumed that this. two versions are equivalent, and it's not so. I mean, it's one has to prove this, and it's a hard conjecture. So why is this important? So the relative version. So if you assume that you have a fibration x to s, so x is not a Calabi-Yau, but x to s, where the fibers of this fibration is a Calabi-Yau, so you have a relative Calabi-Yau in a sense. Then, so if you have the relative version of the cone conjecture, and this was something that was already hinted by Paolo in one of his talks, the relative version of the cone conjecture plus abundance implies that every, let's say, I'm not so sure about KLT, but let's say every terminal variety has only finitely many minimum models. So up to isomorphism. So in this context, the minimum model is forgetting the map. So you have a map from X to the minimum model X min. You do not care about the map. So there might be two different maps to the same minimum model, and you consider these two maps the same. In this sense, they're really, so this is isomorphism in the abstract sense of algebraic varieties, not in the sense of that there is some kind of morphism which commutes with maps. So, I mean, that's definitely false. That version is definitely false. Sorry? Once again? Ah, yes, okay, so MMP, okay. So let's be on. Once again? Yes, full MMP, but abundance is, for me, in the MMP. So, no. No, existence, okay, let me put it like this. So plus existence of good models, okay? It's not termination of flips, it's not necessary. it's not necessary. And part two, if x just, this is just one illustration, but if x is a Calabi-Yau threefold with Picot number two, then this implies, this Kohn conjecture implies that x has rational curves. So existence of rational curves on Calabi-Yau threefolds is a very important problem. We know only existence of curves, rational curves on Calabi-Yau threefolds with a Picot number at least 14. And there are some partial results in lower dimension. Picot number one is completely out of reach. And Picot number two is the only, the first one which is within reach. And so Kawamata's version of the Kohn conjecture is very natural from the point of view of the minimum model program, because if you have an F divisor with, which is effective, then you can somehow manipulate your guys, then you can use abundance in something. Whereas it's not quite clear where Morrison's version comes from. I mean, it comes from the mirror symmetry. It's motivated from mirror symmetry. And somehow it seems, from if you are MMP person, then you are very easily led to believe that Kawamata's version is clearly the right one. There is the following result of Luo Yanhe, which is a completely convex theoretic result, but I will state it in the context of cones in the geometry. So if there exists pi, which is a rational polyhedral cone contained in an F cone, such that when you take all the translates of pi by this group, by the automorphic group of x, such that this guy contains the ample cone, then this guy cannot be anything, then it has to be an F. Okay, I didn't give it a name. Okay, so let's call this guy here Nef plus, Nef x plus. So it has to be Nef x plus. So, so this somehow is completely, to me at least, a counter. I mean, it's very intuitive when you see the result, but it's somehow counterintuitive from the point of view of rational geometry, which. Tells you that if Kawamata's version and Morrison's version of Kohn conjecture are different, I mean, if these two cones are different, then Kawamata's version cannot be true. So that's disturbing. The question, therefore the question is, so now the question, what is the relation? Ideally, one would like to show that these two cones are the same. So what is the relation between the cones? The cones Nef plus, so this rational, so convex hull of the rational guys, and this effective guys. And until now, almost nothing was known. And we can show. It's not published, but the proof is not. I mean, it's not difficult at all. But it used some results of Shukurov and Birkar. So the answer is so far unconditional. Is that this cone here is a subset of this guy? So, so up to now it was known only for hyperkila, so of a certain form. So this guy is contained in F x plus. And then, ideally, so you would like, from the because of rational geometry, you would like these two conjectures, versions of the conjecture, to be the same. And that motivates the following conjecture, which is from whichever point, whichever for whichever reason, it's been around for at least as a folklore for a very long time, is that assume that X is a smooth projective variety with Kx numerically trivial. Assume that X is simply connected or less that, or at least that H1 of Ox is zero, so that you don't get into some kind of numerical problems. Let L be an F line bundle on X, then L is semi-ample. What this thing basically says is two things. Then, so this says two things. L has sections, plus L is semi-ample. If it has sections, then it's semi-ample. And this part, by the way, this part, it's a little bit just technical, but this part is basically abundance for the pair x comma epsilon L, where epsilon is very small. So that's why I said that the Cohn conjecture is a post-abundance problem, that you are more, in a sense, proving more. This conjecture is stronger than abundance conjecture on x hyperkähler. Oh, sorry, on x Calabi-Yau. And just to see that this somehow has also some additional incarnations in hyperkähler geometry, this has a name. This is a projective case of the famous SYZ conjecture. So Strominger-Yau thus. And just very briefly, so we have progress on this, on threefolds. So this, by the way, this conjecture clearly, I mean, if you are removing smoothness, so a projective variety with, let's say, terminal singularity or something, this implies this. So this inclusion is the conjecture. So somehow it seems that this conjecture, even though it has been around for a long time, maybe it's not completely out of reach. And so with Pétainel, so this is a very difficult problem. I mean, nothing is known in dimension. So in dimension two is known completely, and in dimension three, nothing is known. And with Pétainel-Ogizzo, we can show in picket number two, if X has picket number two, we can show that currently, if kappa sigma of L is 2. So, I mean, kappa sigma can be 0, 1, 2, and 3. When kappa sigma is 0 or 3, it's already known by base point free theorem and by some other results. And there are only two cases, 1 or 2. And when kappa is 2, then we can show. We are very close to proving in the case when kappa XL is 1. And we are not so close, but we are a little bit further down. So we are generalizing, we can generalize most of the proof, or at least a certain point of the portion of the proof, to any Picard number. And now this is a work in progress. So, just to mention in one sentence what the method of the proof is. So basically, we want to study log differentials, where for a suitable, and we want to find a suitable d such that this guy behaves in a certain way. For example, we can show that when d is very ample. And D is very general in the linear system D, then this guy here, when restricted to every curve, is an F. This is an F vector bundle. And this we use, this is one of the key things in the proof of this result. Thank you, sorry.